I mean, the kangaroo-sized cashew wouldn't be terrifying. That'd be delicious.
And welcome back to another Linux Gamecast Weekly. The show covers the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how-tos, and most importantly, whatever the hell else we come up with. I'm Old Man Vin, old member. And middle-aged Jordan, we've been doing this. So that was one of the comments we got on our Odyssey or libraries. Like, you've been doing this so long, it should be middle-aged. We're getting there. We're getting there, man. And as always, except when he's not, Peter Mateus. Yeah.
Except for a few weeks over the year. Yeah.
Together with you, Shadow Realm Dynamic, helping us for. You know him, you love him. Bifurcated, Kane.
Two Canes.
Voltron.
Two Canes.
Kind of excited. Okay, I got one thing that made me really excited that I finally got. I talked about it a little bit in the pre-show. I got... this is an empty box. I don't know why I did that. I think it's just like one of those things when you pick up a big box, your brain's like, just make the noise. Do the thing, Bart. It's got some stuff in it. This is the Tascam. 1608.
The big chunker.
Yeah, the big chunker. I posted, but up here in like this quarter... is the reason I've had multiple opportunities to buy these at great prices used, and it's the rack ears, because apparently the step one is you buy it and you throw the fucking rack ears out, then you put it on Reverb or eBay to sell it. And I finally found one, and this is the one I had to fight with, because Guitar Center had this, and I'm like, yo, yeah, I'll take it. And I went all through all the things that I go to check out, and Guitar Center's like, psych, you can't buy it. I'm like, what the fuck? So I went to their sister site with the same image with the same thing, and I bought it there, and it showed up. That was my excited thing. But I got this because this is one of the few interfaces that has full onboard DSP, routing, mixing. It's got EQ, compression, and most importantly, a GUI that you can run from Linux. So you can pull up, like, you can run this thing all by itself from that GUI, like do, you know, a good chunk of what we do here, just in a smaller fashion. Stay tuned for that. And yeah, the bad thing is I straight up bricked my Mikrotik AC3 Wi-Fi distributor puck thing. Because I did it dumb. 100% on me. 100% on me. I had logged into the access point through Winbox, and I'm looking at it, I'm like, oh, look, there's a new version. And it's like, oh, because Mikrotik Wi-Fi is just bad. So I take any opportunity to update it. So I went to update it. I'm like, you know what? Since I'm here, let's open another Winbox session and log into the Mikrotik 4011. I'm like, yeah, let's just do that update too. About when it was at 98.99% getting ready to download, I went, wait a minute. Oops. That's PoE to the access point. That isn't trying to in the middle of an upgrade.
Oops.
Hashtag Henry Cavill JPEG. Fuck. Yeah. And the 4011 finished its cycle. It got done. And, you know, of course, I just sat there and, like, false hope stared at it for like 15 minutes. Like, maybe it'll figure itself out. Fortunately, Mikrotik is definitely a company that will they're all Linux powered devices, and they give you a loaded gun, man. They're like, yeah, we understand that you can easily, without doing something that brain dead, you can break your router and lock your router up. You have that option. They don't stop you. So you can do a thing called net install, which takes forever. Like, they have a Linux GUI. It's not a GUI, but a command line tool for Linux where you can do it in like force load, where it creates its own network and it works. Here's my advice. If you ever have to like do a net install under Linux, I'm sure it's the same under Windows or whatever you're running, set it and forget it. Cause it took like 20 minutes to figure itself out. And it just started working. I was getting ready to just stop and try again. And it loaded. So that's my story. How about you, Pedro?
My story is...
Have you bricked a router this week?
No, but no. I did at the beginning of the week. I had a bit of a scare because last Sunday, the update for kernel 5.19 came out, 5.19.9. And since I'm using Nobara now, that showed up in the repo. It's like, hey, let's update. And then the very next day, turn on PC. Why am I only getting output? Where did the input go? I know that this, you know, it's Behringer 202. It's not, you know, anything spectacular, but it does both input and output. So what's going on? Went to look at the kernel thread, the kernel Bugzilla, and found a thread. It's like, oh, there's a bunch of interfaces like the 202, the 404, there was a Motu, I think it was the M2, and a few others that just didn't work at all. You either got input or output, not both. So had to do a bit of a kernel downgrade.
No, the piece of resistance, the big tease, is in the show notes where Jordan has nosey naibas.
Yeah, so I'm sitting there in my in this office on a Wednesday, feeling good on a Wednesday,
chilling out,
working away, doing my job.
Yeah,
and I'm like, I hear a knock on the door, and I'm like, well, that's strange. No one knocks on my door. And so I go upstairs and open up the door, and there's a guy in a blue uniform, and I'm like, oh shit, is it the cops? And it's like, no, it's city bylaw enforcement. So apparently there's been an individual or a collection of individuals who's been walking around our neighborhood, and according to this bylaw enforcement officer, just been reporting fucking everyone. Like, too many sticks out in the yard. Oh, there are weeds here. Oh, your garage door is uneven, blah blah blah. Because apparently these are like some really desperate, craven individuals who lack control in their life to the degree where they need to go around and
live in a nice area of Toronto, right?
I live in the suburbs. So like it's, I wouldn't call this a nice area. There's like a park nearby. The property values are insane here, but that's just like pick a spot in Toronto.
Pick a spot in a big city. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, so I get the warning. They're like, yeah, no fines this time, but you gotta take care of this stuff. And it's like, okay,
what was the stuff?
Like a bunch of debris in front of our house that actually belongs to the city. They need to come and pick that shit up.
Oh,
because there was a hurricane a couple weeks ago that blew a bunch of that shit over into our backyard. Yeah, and it's their tree. They left like an extra garbage bin on our property. Like, we didn't ask for it, but it's there. We found out who they are because. My girlfriend's office, it looks over the front of the house. And so she sees these two people, they're going through the neighborhood and they're snooping in people's backyards. And they're like, they got a notepad and they're taking notes. And so these fuckers, these like, frankly, sad, pathetic fuckers are going around reporting people just because they lack control in their lives. So now I gotta deal with that shit. That's my funny story.
Fucks.
Yeah.
Do they live in the neighborhood? Do you know who they like?
I don't even know. Like, I don't think they live in on the neighborhood. They live in one of the like adjacent streets. And like the fact that they were complaining about stuff in our backyard means that I think they're on like the street behind us. And like there's a bunch of trees dividing the property. So they're like fucking looking through and spying on us. Shit. So I think next time we see them, we're going to call the cops, report a bunch of suspicious figures walking around.
And taking notes, yeah, looking into our property and taking notes,
I think we're being scouted for a robbery, officer. You should come here and do something about that. Here's a picture of him.
Here's my first thought. Well, I was like, find the fucking house, and we'll get together, and we'll finance you a drone to fly in front of their fucking top story window.
Oh, yeah.
And we'll just put a comical camera on it. So.
Just a vuvuzela connected to an air horn connected to a Raspberry Pi goes off at random points.
Oh, man. One thing you never have to worry about, stupid on, is our horse. It minds its own damn business.
Yeah, it's because it doesn't have any eyes anymore. They've dissolved into the gelatinous pile that is the steam. Man, it's been 10 years. We can't be expected to memorize our own section introduction.
There was extra echo this time around.
Bonus echo.
But you know what? Something that has also been around for an inordinate amount of time is the complaint that we've had that there you can't really easily find games that your friends also own. And so there is a new update to the beta client that now allows you to list friends as a filter when you're looking for games. And hell, if you have a group chat of up to 8 people, you can filter based on that as well, which is really nice. before you would need to like have to go to like all the individual friends' friend page and be like, what games do we have in common? Now there's a very convenient way to find it. I wish they had a thing like a right click option that are just like, hey, show me all the friends who own this game. But like this is the first step to that. So it's good to see that after, I don't know, how long has Steam networking been a thing? How long has Steam multiplayer been a thing? Like 12 years, 13 years?
I mean, it was like a multiplayer client at first.
Yeah. Well, online, yeah. So, yeah. So, you know, it's about time they got this feature.
Yeah, and the September 22 update, there have been a couple of more beta updates since that one. The September 22 one, it lets you search for friends using your custom nicknames, Jordan.
Yes, Aslan.
Precisely. That was the only person that I know that actually went through the trouble.
Exactly. Jordan, I love that. He's put in more effort than all of us combined in like,
yes.
creative
naming. Yes.
And there was also an update on the 21st, which fixed a black screen when people were trying to stream, do the in-home streaming to a Linux box.
Oh.
That's been fixed now, too, so very nice.
Nice. Hey, we got a changelog for Proton Experimental.
And, we do!
Yeah,
we know we have to look at a git diff.
Here's no, we thing, don't. Though. No, we don't. But before we get to that, I love that Jordan put a thing in, because you went down the exact same rabbit hole, but you went through it before I got back to like put it in the notes, because you're like, wait a minute, what is the what was it? The
NVIDIA.
I'm like, why is that? I know that for some reason. I'm like, oh, right. After I went through and did, it's like, yeah, I have that enabled. You have to enable that to make sure the DLSS works.
Yeah.
Because Proton lies to your system. It says that everyone has an AMD card. Well, it used to. Now there's like 50 games that it no longer does that to.
The Twin Stones, to hell with it. The Redress of Mirror demo, the actual Redress of Mirror, a bunch of the Tomb Raiders, Lego Builder's Journey, Cyberpunk. Yeah, giant
Spider-Man, fucking number. MechWarrior 5. Yeah.
Back yeah, for and, blood. Yeah, and all stuff you that really kind of requires DLSS to, you know, not run like not ass. But yeah, that's going to be good.
Get diff this time is because there's bold. There's extra bold to indicate the changes since the last version, since they last edited it. So I'm pretty sure there's someone in the Valve development team that's watching the show. Hello!
Well, at least they're not watching it upside down anymore, because that was another bug that got fixed with this.
Yeah, videos in VR were upside down. How does that... What?
Like, how could you tell?
LGC Australia mode. It's how Mr. Foxdog experiences life.
I did go back and try a couple of things. This is what like led to my discovery. I'm like, this NVAPI thing. I was like, you know what? I'll just download God of War. I had that laying around. And I looked in like my launch options and I'm like, oh, right. I had to like manual enable that. Let me disable that. And of course, the DLSS, it just showed back up. I'm like, okay, that works. And it still doesn't have a screen resolution setting for full screen. God of War developers.
Well, yeah, you're playing it on a TV, right? It's a PlayStation game.
It has to run in 3840 by 2160. It's like either that or get wrecked. And I look forward to my Wayland future. Not the only thing from Steam this week. We got something that's kind of interesting. Time has come. Real time and weekly Steam charts. A new home for charts showcasing the top selling and most played games on Steam. Yay. Real-time top sellers. We'll go to the overview page in a minute. We'll just take a look. What do we have? Weekly change in ring, region switcher, total revenue, real-time most played. Man, the Steam DB guy must have pissed somebody off at Valve. Valve was like, you know what? Fuck this. We'll make our own.
I genuinely thought that whoever was writing those like monthly bestseller posts, they're just like, listen, man, you got to give me something else to do. I'm dying here. Fucking automate this shit. You're asking me to run a database query once a month and write an article. You can just make an app that shows the database query. It's fine. Well,
the first thing I thought about when I saw this is I'm like, hey, can we get a real time Steam? Here, let's take a look at what we have. Here's our charts overview. Peak online, 28 million online right now, 18 million. And you can go through the dates with the charts. Top selling games, Call of Dude Bros, Too Spooky for You.
Makes sense. That came out this week.
A bunch of free games. Apex.
Well, Cyberpunk, Jump Back Up, Gundam Evolution, and yeah, of course, the most played are the free games. Yeah, Counter-Strike, yeah. Dota, Apex.
People are getting into Cyberpunk again because the anime came out, and they're like, oh my god, I want to reproduce all the builds of the characters.
As it turns out, the anime is not terrible. So
yeah. Okay, I will say this much. I watched, here's what, like, it threw me off a little bit. I went down and like, you know what? Fine, I'll watch it because Netflix will just annoy the absolute living shit out of you when something new is like 1% in like whatever it thinks demo that you're in. And I cut it on and I went, it opens strong, man. That first episode, I'm like, holy shit. Animation's top notch. It's
Studio Trigger. They do some pretty good stuff.
Oh no, I saw somebody try to pull that shit and because on Reddit, they're like, yeah, they're trying to do an anime thing from what I'm like, the studio is anime, motherfucker.
Yeah, go watch Inferno Cop. If you want to see like pure Studio Trigger, like zero budget, go watch Inferno Cop. It's great.
It is completely well done. But the thing that like my brain just was not, it was one of those rare, it was like late. It was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, I can't do the subtitles right now. So I kind of did it. Does it have an English dub?
I didn't check. Yes, it started in Japanese with the subtitles like
Giancarlo Esposito, isn't it?
All right.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Back to the Steam charts. It's actually not obsoleting the original Steam charts, the unofficial ones, because the only thing you get, as in like concurrent players here, is the most played. So if you're still looking for, you know, a specific game and see how many, what the average was for the past day or for the past month or whatever, that you still need to go through the old Steam charts. So
I didn't even know they had the chart for support stats.
Huh. Yeah, that was new. It's like, that's tooting your own horn and you can just lie about that because no one's going to know.
Quit being a negative Nancy. They didn't have to put that up to begin with.
Yes, yeah. They did not.
I mean, if they were really bullshitting the numbers, then they would have like zero people waiting for a response, right?
No one would believe them.
I mean, no one's believing them now, so what's the point? Right?
It's believable enough. Now, what I want is I want to see this roll out because, you know, we've said it a billion times over the years. They have the data. Let's get those real time GPU, CPU, and OS usages. Even if you want to do it weekly, like give me the data, but
the actual numbers. Yes. Cause hang on. Just the people on the survey. Yeah.
That would genuinely be a helpful tool for developers to have that information at hand.
Yeah. I wonder how much of that has to be like opt-in though. Cause like, I guess you've agreed if you've signed up for the Steam subscriber agreement,
right.
Valve can like fucking show up in your house and fucking steal your dog. And you've signed away the rights to that. So
right.
I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, the survey as it stands is already opt-in. If you get the survey thing, you could choose not to do it.
Yes, but that's why those survey numbers are absolute bullshit, because it is a self-selected group of people who are actually submitting that data. So I don't know. There's some privacy concerns there, obviously, but I think they could figure out a way to do it relatively anonymously.
Yeah, even if they want to. Yeah, they can anonymize the data, but I mean, sure, this is stuff they're already collecting.
They could just publish the numbers, you know, not actually link back to any specific data. Just say there's X amount of this, X amount of that.
But who will believe them, skeptical Pedro Mateus?
Hey man, I want to be able to, I want to drill down. It's like, what was James playing at 3:40 p.m. on what operating system?
That's the new fucking meme. Like, your friend's playing a hentai game writ large. Yeah.
I mean, you could already do that by just having the Steam client running through the terminal and tailing the output to a file. And then you can see when the pop-up messages show up because it shows up.
Huh. Big data Mateus over here.
I know.
I'm just saying, you can already do that if they're your friends.
With his data lake.
I saw one game this week that is their new game segment. I thought it was worth a mention, mainly because of like old times' sake. Because I remember Flashout number 2, Flashlight number 2.
Which very slow. Flat out. There's a bunch of games that have that naming out. Convention. Yeah. Yeah.
Apparently, we're on number 3 at this point, and you know, this is always going to be curiosity.
We have Cyberpunk at home.
for there's a section of our audience, myself and Pedro included, we're like, oh, racing games. Yeah, we like that. And this one was always kind of harking back. Everyone is looking for the spiritual successor to the original, like, hover slide game.
Episode one, pod racing, or wipeout. What
was it called? Wipeout.
F-Zero, wipeout, that kind of, you know, fast-paced hover ship type of situation.
Yeah.
I played a lot of Wipeout 2097 on the Saturn. I love that game.
Well, so. This one, hey man, Fleshlight is back. High speed meat sticks. Definitely, I went back and looked, and graphical improvement? Yeah. You know what? It is. I mean, it does kind of look like pod racing with some of the cars, but I think it's been since 2014. Yeah, 8 years. Okay. It's taken place since Flashlight 2 and Flashlight 3. And I was like, okay, you know what? You know what? Oh, and VR support for like the 11 of you who have VR headsets. I was I might try it out. Scroll down, take a look. $20 in single player. So you just get fucked. No.
Yeah, no, split screen only. Ugh, no, well, no bueno.
You gotta have some balls to release a racing game in 2022, and it's like, yeah, you can only play it with yourself. Like, that, like, doesn't make sense.
How does that conversation even happen, right? Like,
it doesn't happen. That's the thing, the conversation never happened.
I guess I don't know.
I like racing against myself and AI component. Everyone will know, the kids are wrong.
Oh. Yes, it's the children who are wrong. Well, they're right about Splitgate.
Couple updates, right?
Yeah.
Last time I blinked, we were at Splitgate 1.0. Things have changed. Apparently, oh, yeah. they're at 8. They count faster than I do, man. A couple of new things in this. New maps, new tiers, gang of game modes that I didn't know about. Apparently, there's sprays in the games, and they've updated name tags. They've also added a thing to help single out moderators. If you're a moderator, you get a special attack this guy first badge.
Yeah. this is also coming up as the end of development update, because they said previously that they're going to be, I guess, focusing on the successor to Splitgate 2, whatever you want to call it. Splitdoor, Splitgate SG1, Splitgate Atlantis. I don't fucking know. But yeah, so they've had this thing called the Battle Pass that is now going infinite. It was giving people items. Some of them were unique, and apparently by now all of the unique items have been claimed. But because they want to leave this game in a position where, like, even though there's no longer active development happening, people can still play it, and like the ladder will still function. So what they're doing now is unique drops will now get duplicated over time. They gave the formula for how that's going to happen. So even if you have some unique shit, it's still going to remain mostly unique for a while. I think once it hits the 8-year mark, then it just kind of sprays and prays all the good loot. But you know, the plan is to let this go on forever and ever. And I mean, that's good, right? Like, they, considering that they're packing up shop and making a new game, they could have been like, yeah, that was fun. You know, all the servers are shutting down, get fucked. But they're trying to continue making Splitgate playable and preservable for the foreseeable future, which is
well. My immediate first question to that is, can you run your own servers?
I think they're keeping servers up and running. I don't know about dedicated servers though. Someone will need to look that.
I mean, that's such a uncommon thing, and there's a reason we play Trackmania. And the reason we're able to play Trackmania Squared Stadium on Tuesdays and Thursdays is because they're like, hey, you can make your own server. And 13 years after the game's release, or 11 years after that, you know, 20 years from now, you can still find a way to get it up and running. So many of these games, like, this was free to play. And, you know, this game's only had 23 years of development that kind of pieced out with it. So I can imagine maybe that's going to be some hesitation, like, in the next thing they make. Especially if you dumped a lot of money into cosmetics. Yeah.
So they do say that it's their servers that they're running. They're going to keep them up indefinitely. Hopefully they're going to release a dedicated server if they ever decide to shut that down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That would be very nice. Although I can see why they'd also want to keep the infinite battle pass going. Yeah. Because if a new player happens to find the old game and goes, oh, I want some of the stuff that's on the pass, they can pay for the pass and then get the premium stuff. And that's just money that keeps coming in without, you know, active development. So that's good for them, too.
And actually, there's a free battle pass now as well, so you don't even need to pay into that.
There was always the free tier, but yeah, it's all infinite now.
People have learned, like, the cycle of life was, have a server, not release a server that anybody else can use, have the community reverse engineer a server and use that, have a great time with it, especially with an abandoned version of a game, then Blizzard come back and sues your ass and remakes the old game. And
and then continues to ruin it all over again.
Oh, man.
And it still baffles me that EA is okay with Need for Speed World and the community efforts to bring that game back from the dead, because I play a lot of it. And it's all thanks to the community. So
EA is a weird one, because look at Command and Conquer, right? That is literally being kept alive by the community right now. Yeah. So I guess EA is like, okay, listen, if you're not gonna sell it and you're not gonna cost you and it's not gonna cost us anything,
you're not gonna charge for it. Yeah, have at
go.
Well, something I definitely want to throw down. When we go to a game that had its entire life cycle take place in 3 years, this is in stark comparison to the next story, our next update.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Because, as it turns out, Dead Cells has been around for a while. 2018, that it came out of early access. It wasn't early access for a couple of years before that. But still supported. And they're pushing out the next alpha. Basically, it's an action roguelite. If you've never played it, imagine... What's it called?
Roguelite Symphony. Infinite Symphony of the Night, pretty much.
Very much with the platforming and the fluid combat and that type of situation. But they're adding a boss rush mode. That's the big thing here. If you've been unlocking stuff, the third door after the tailor in the where you start is going to be the boss rush rooms. You can do 3 bosses, you can do 5 bosses, you can have modifiers or not have modifiers, and they also have a special challenge mode if you can beat all 5 bosses with modifiers without taking any damage, flawless mode. That's evil. They're also introducing some, as part of the rewards for the boss rush, they're introducing some few unlocks, some cosmetic, others less so, and some new legendary item affixes. Those are not specific to the boss rush. You might be able to get one just in-game normally. They do recommend that you back up your save games. They don't expect anything to break, but, you're going to an alpha version. It's recommended, recommended.
That's an easy safety net to do, though, right? Yes. Like, hey, it's on you. And when you say, like, oh, somebody, like, it might be super difficult, not no hits or anything like that. Everything's out the window, because I saw, what was her name? The butterfly boss from Elden Ring.
Mm.
You know, the hard one.
The one with fucking wings, yes, the leper one. Lady. Yes. Melania.
Yeah, I saw a lady. I saw a Twitch clip of a lady beating her with a Nintendo Power Pad.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to the Donkey Kong Conga controller no-hit run of Elden Ring. They are soliciting feedback for the alpha, though, because I think they're still tuning some of the balance for Boss Rush. They've listed a couple known issues, and they have a link to their bug submission form in the post, so definitely check that out.
I mean, this is like borderline Team Cherry commitment to your title. And support afterwards and bringing in new content. So good on that if you're a fan of Dead Cells.
Yeah, they're constantly interacting with or interfacing with the fans as well. So, good on them for keeping this alive. Coming up next, you thought you were done paying thousands of dollars for NVIDIA cards.
The shortage is over.
The news, they're coming. But, we do need to.
You mean the rose.
The ruse have eyes. Well, I guess I don't they know. Do.
Come on, then. You think
about they got what? Too they got too many eyes, man.
What they are mammals, so they probably have eyes.
What would be more terrifying, 10 cashew-sized kangaroos or 1 kangaroo-sized cashew?
I mean, the kangaroo-sized cashew wouldn't be terrifying. That'd be delicious.
the little kangaroos could, like, get inside your nose and, like,
both of y'all bitches are trying to pretend that you don't know at what size a cashew becomes sentient.
about yay big, then they start screaming, please don't
Still delicious. harder to eat without feeling guilty, but still delicious.
I don't feel deliciousness guilty. Is exponential with this engine.
Deliciousness is directly correlated to edibility or to sentience. There you go. Mm-hmm. Patreon.com/LinuxGamecast. If you want to eat our delicious brains, what's wrong with you? They taste like shit, but you can give us money.
Hey, you know what? That worked. That's
good. You know what? Go buy the Splitgate Battle Pass. It's infinite now. Head on over to patreon.com/LinuxGamecast. Sign up. You get some cool stuff. You get access to our Discord channel, which you can also get by subbing to us on Twitch, twitch.tv/LinuxGamecast. Getting inside our Discord gets you some crazy stuff, like the ability to talk to us the rest of the week. We have game streams on Tuesdays.
That's right.
Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays that you can RSVP to. On them, you get your name in the credits. Depending on how much money you give us, you are higher up on the list. So if you want to like crab bucket your way up, you can. We got some. We actually
don't
got
even
some,
ask about bold. You can't afford it.
Yeah, we can't. We got some new patrons. We gotta thank
italics. You might be able to get away with. That's not matter.
What about strike through? Can you give me some strike through?
I don't even want to think about trying to render strike the fucking resolve.
Yeah. So we gotta thank Mark. Oh, hi, Mark. How's your sex life? We also gotta thank Replay Gaming PT. They're our brand new patrons. I would give
Replay Gaming PT a little extra shout out because we've been doing Filthy Casuals is our adult racing game, our retro racing with Trackmania 2.
Adult racing? Is that like adult entertainment?
No, it's older people playing a video game.
Okay.
Geriatric racing, yes.
Canadians, man, everything's straight to porn.
I mean, yeah.
We do this for sexy. 38 weeks. And like you go to our server, you know, you get the game up and running, whatever you're playing it, and you'll see the Filthy Casuals is like listed in the server browser, and you click on it, there's the description like, hey, you know, we're just trying to have some fun. We're not pro racers, we're just playing. It's an excuse on Tuesdays and Fridays to just hang out, talk Linux and anything else going on while we're trying to puzzle our way around new maps. And it says, hey, if you're Twitch sub or if you're a patron, do that. Link the Discord and passwords pinned in the Trackmania's in 38 weeks, gentlemen. 38 weeks. No one's ever been able to complete that loop. It is always, can I please have password?
Reading Winky. Is hard, man.
No. They read it just fucking fine, baby. They're like, no, you just give it to me. And I'm like, no, we're keeping you home. Because every time you open it up, you get the tryhards immediately flying in. They're like, I can beat up toddlers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's great. You walk into that kindergarten playground and you just kick them in the fucking head.
So yeah, Replay Gaming, PT, thank you. Because you completed the loop. He's just like, hey, how do I get in? And explained it. Like 5 minutes later, he's like, I'm racing, bitches. Like
right on. It's that easy.
The Portuguese person was the one to do it right.
Yep.
I know. We would have all lost money on that, wouldn't we?
Unless PT stands for potato.
He did mention on the live stream. Okay. I was watching the live stream and I saw it's like, oh, Portuguese, right on.
At least we got one Portuguese in that race.
Without cheating. Well, you know, speaking of, we got a store, store.linuxgamecast.com. Cover yourself in LGC apparel. Stop the people from smelling your horrible BO and instead smell the chemical cleaners that we wash our shirts with, I guess. We got stickers, we got coffee cups, we got hoodies, we got t-shirts. It's good stuff. It's all decent quality. It won't disintegrate the first time you shove it in a washing machine, which is pretty good. What else we got? We got our wish zones. If we head on over to linuxgamecast.com, put your mouse over the support button. I have one. Ven has one. Jill has one. Pedro has one. We have stuff that we want that you can buy us to make our lives easier, to improve the quality of what you're watching and or listening to here. And if you buy Ven some stuff, you can get your name in lights. Well, in phosphorescent marker.
Hey man, what are you guys? I'm creeping right now. I'm creeping. I'm seeing. Yep. Has anybody added anything fun?
No, I haven't really
been removing things from mine. I've been buying them. That's it.
The AK gun, the AK guitar is out of stock. Damn it.
It's out of stock, man. I always like to go through these. I'm like, is any of this like applicable to the show that I can write off on fucking taxes? And,
well, some of it is, some of it isn't. You can definitely write off $1,000 audio cable as part of your.
Oh yeah. No, the Apoogie Duet 3, that would be for the show.
Jordan pointed out, this is one for the studio. It's far less interesting. I'm kind of curious about that we're talking about in the pre-show. If you have any experience with the SK Hynix drives, send me a note. Let me know, because I'm thinking about doing that. Outside of that, we're building a epic gaming rig. So that's going to be in play. Doing all the stuff. We thank you for your support, each and every one of you. Stick around for your name. Not in lights. Well, epic your name with in lights, if you can anything from me on that one. But definitely in the credits, which take like 9 minutes to render. That's why we don't need strike through, because I don't know how DaVinci's going to handle that.
What about Zalgo text?
You know what? I would. Yeah, I am almost like fuck around and find out with that.
yeah, that's just a copy paste. Do a simple test render. Oh, that works.
Because as simple as that text is rolling by, that is like straight up 3D. The entire thing, man. It's like, yeah, I got a camera plane on it. Which you might need a 40 series RTX to render if you don't want to wait 9 minutes like I have to each and every week. And good luck, everyone.
And that's if you got like $1,200 to burn on it.
Dude, this stuff is like wicked cheap. What are you talking about? They're practically giving away the new Ada Lovelace Gen 3 RTX is on, bitches. 40 series graphics cards. NVIDIA's got an announcement. And you should pay attention. DLSS 3.0 is a new thing. They get new versions of the NV encode, which, you know, that's neat. Not only do you just get one, you get second NV encode, which on top of that can do AV1 encoding. So now NVIDIA is probably going to beat Intel to the game with like reasonable AV1 encoding, which is just maddening when you think about it.
Not reasonably now, priced, though.
Well, we'll get to that. The 4090. Here's what I like. Do we have any? There's Mr. Leather Jacket holding that chungus, also going, what are you holding that by, Jensen? I have questions.
It's glued to his hand.
I guess. Okay, we got a little background noise. So the 4090 low, low price, non-scalper price, 24 gig is $1,599 US.
Oh.
Followed by the 480, which is 16 gigs. Now, isn't there there's the 480 and not, wait, no, the 480 is 16 gigs, $1,199. Isn't there one below that, Pedro?
Yeah, or? There's the 480 with 12 gigs for $999.
But it's not a 480.
That's just worse. I mean, if it's going to be a lower spec graphics card for $1,000, effectively what you'd get with the previous 70 series.
By all accounts, I mean, it is completely like shaved down. It's cut down. It's a 480 in name only. It's got a 192-bit memory bus, which is like half thousand less CUDA doodles. It is not a 480 NVIDIA. Nobody's buying that shit. Now, if the last 2 years has taught us anything, it's scalper pricing. Kind of sucks. Isn't that right, Jensen? No? Come on. I think it is. Well, we're getting Portal RTX, gentlemen. So
Portal 1. Ooh.
Yeah, but hey, man. Now you can struggle to play Portal at 720p with RTX on. It'll be awesome. Yeah. It'll just be like Quake 2.
I can try it with software ray tracing on my 1080 Ti, now, and it'll get like one frame a second.
With this insane pricing, it is not outside the realm of possibility that we're probably going to see NVIDIA at least fucking try, at least try to sell a $500 4060.
60 series for $500?
Yeah.
they're going to take a swipe at it, man, because, you know, hey, man, we got to worry about this small little startup NVIDIA. You know, they've grown accustomed past couple of years for that revenue stream from the miners, you know, who are just buying them by the pallets and like, I don't care, $2,000, give me more, I'll take them, we can turn a profit. I think they might have forgot that consumers, we weren't, the average person is not putting up with that shit. We were just like, I'll sit back and wait, motherfucker, I can do that. And this is going to be doubly hard, which this is like two parts, though, because we all know, because it's already starting to happen, that first initial salvo of the miner cards showing up, we talked about last week, 30 series cards, like very fucking reasonably priced, and there's nowhere to go but down, baby. Slightly mined 70 series, 3070, which you probably couldn't get your hands on anyway, when those start getting around $300, that changes things up, man. Now, here's what I'm thinking, though. We got that AMD announcement coming up at the beginning of next month.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed.
RDNA3. AMD, hear me out. Hear me out. Because you can disrupt the absolute living fuck out of the GPU market if you want to. If you want to get medieval with that pricing, AMD. And I mean, not slightly less greedy pricing, not a jabate bullshit. I'm talking about some old school medieval, like 2014, 2015 fucking. Here's our fucking YOLOtron 9000. $600 top of the line. How many will you buy? That'll fuck up the market a little bit. That'll make NVIDIA fucking blink, especially if you can deliver some AV1 encoding on that card. You got my money. I'll fucking do that. And you got the ability to, even though I don't have the exact financials, the 40 series is still based on a monolithic die. You got to think about the yields of those motherfuckers. The bigger the fucking die gets, lower your yields get. That's just how this shit works. Doesn't matter if it's a GPU, CPU. We're talking about silicon wafers, man. AMD's doing chiplets for RDNA3. They got wiggle room. I guarantee you their fucking yields are going to be better. And, you know, the whole packaging system. So here's the last thing, though, I'll say about this for you guys. Tell me how wrong I am. How much of this pricing, because this is shock pricing. Like, nobody looked at this and went, that's reasonable. You know, $1,500 for the 90 and $1,100 for a fucking 480. Ish. That's shock pricing. You look at that and you're like, is this NVIDIA trying to keep the 30 series? Because there's, you can't even walk out the front door without tripping over a mined 30 series card. Just giving them away, that there's a glut of these cards. Are they trying to keep that price maintained where it just doesn't crater out completely by making the 40 series unobtainium?
I don't know. I think maybe there's a little bit of that. I think maybe there's a little bit of like, oh man, yeah, we don't have to worry about these Intel cards. We're not remotely competing with them at all. Not even at any level. So there's definitely some
we're going to be the first ones to a mass market with AV1 encoding.
Yeah. And here's the thing. Like, I've been watching these announcements with bated breath because I'm in the market for a new GPU. These two yahoos already made their purchases, so they're sitting pretty. But $900 for what is effectively a 4070 is not really another purchase that I want to swallow, especially if I can get a used 3080 or 3090 for less than that. And yeah, hopefully the 7000 series, the AMD RDNA3 stuff, that's going to be more reasonably priced. I don't know.
They just keep the 6000 series pricing, that's just going to be so much better.
Yeah. And I guess the one gotcha there is if the driver stack is too different, I may need to wait until like October of next year to actually use it under Linux. But so far they've been pretty good about that. Actually,
like the 5000 and 6000 series were pretty much out of the box.
Well, so no, 5000 took several months for that.
The 5000 was like 2 months
and the 6000 is like, yeah, enough of the driver space is the same that we can just update the stuff that we have. We don't really know what's going on with the AMD side. I'm sure we're probably going to see some commits from the Mesa change log in a couple months.
I think there was already a dump a while back, last month.
They dumped the initial Navi.
Because I remember Linus making a quote. He was like, hey, don't get too excited. That million lines of code, that was all AMD shit.
Yeah, and I know the new version of Mesa that just came out, that has a bunch of Intel Arc stuff in there as well.
AMD release to actual functioning product, is that gap is closing. You know, you can say a lot of shit and write 100% correct shit about NVIDIA, but that Linux driver will be out the day before it's fucking released. Mm-hmm.
Hopefully it won't be insane, because I've already spent over $1,000 on a video card. I don't want to do that again. I really don't. But maybe here's instead I can take that.
Jordan, like top of the line AMD card at $600, you buying it?
Yeah, I think so. Depends on what it's given, but $600, that's a pretty good young
7800 XT.
Yeah. If it can beat 11 gigs of VRAM and comes and like gives me enough of a performance boost that I can justify it. There
you
go. Yeah.
Like you got a YOLO card. Okay, 16 gigs. Even at that price though, they can be a little bit greedy. Let's say $700 top of the line. 16 gigs.
Like 700 is about the ceiling of what I'm willing to pay. Something in that realm, I think, is what I would end up getting.
Yeah, basically, as long as it's price performance with that, and it's within, because you're gonna get some definitely like spite buys AMD. Mm-hmm. Again, a lot of us are like, get fucked, NVIDIA.
We bought the 6700 XT, and this whole thing, except for like NVIDIA Remix, that was actually interesting. But the rest of it and the pricing, especially, that's just confirmation bias for me. It's like,
I mean, I was holding my breath for fucking Intel to come out with something, anything really.
Right.
And so now it's like, well, if NVIDIA is going to play this way, well, I guess we're going to Team Red.
Exciting times, maybe we live in them.
I could save my money, though, and instead I could buy a GPD Win 4, yep. maybe.
You could. In fact, they have a little breakdown of the GPD Win 4 versus the Steam Deck. And it is, it is, if you remember the GPD Win 3, this one's very similar. It's got the slidey up screen, though they have a physical keyboard this time around instead of being just the touchy bits.
That looks like a PSP, man. Like, that's straight up a Sony PSP.
It is. It very much looks like the form factor is almost exactly the same as the Vita's. And the screen's bigger, significantly. And the actual volume of the thing is, it's very better low than profile. A Steam
Deck. They said it. Better than Steam Deck.
It's got 16 or 32 gigs of RAM variants. You can go up to a 2 terabyte NVMe SSD, and it has the Ryzen 6800U processor, which is the big fancy one with the RDNA2 integrated graphics, like the one on the Steam Deck, but with better CPU cores.
Windows 11, bitch. Now how much would you pay?
Built-in Steam client. Oh, man.
Yeah, so the little table that they have at the bottom of the site is where I got most of my kicks out of this one, which was, let's see, they had... The CPU Geekbench score that they have is from the one that they got for the Steam Deck, was pulled from the Geekbench browser from a Steam Deck running Windows, which is the very top result. I'm pretty sure they were the ones who read it, who ran it. The 2 terabyte SSD option makes me think, since, you know, the cheapest GPD Win 3 was actually like $850, the entry level, with the Intel CPU. So we're looking probably minimum 900.
Well, see, this is the superior machine. It has dual OS support because you can't run Windows on a Steam Deck. But, like, honestly, I gotta say, the shitty GPD marketing aside, it does look like a pretty cool device. I like the idea of having external GPU support. And their target here is like 1080p low as opposed to like 800p at like 30. So I don't know how much, like, actually this will compete against the Steam Deck in terms of, like, power and like, actual gameplay time. I think, like, the Steam Deck's 800p 30 is a good compromise for, like, maximal battery life versus play time. These guys are trying to be like, oh, well, we can outperform it with, like, 30 minutes of battery.
The only thing that they have there is just, we have a bigger battery. But you have an APU that draws a lot more screen. Power, yep. too.
Yep. No, yeah, no, and a 1080p screen that sucks more power, absolutely.
You're just hating. See, this is meant to separate people with more money than sense completely. Why? You can tell, because there's the dog whistle. What is that? Our ARGB ambient lighting on the shoulder buttons.
Of course.
Picture of Mario in the marketing material, yeah, Nintendo might have an issue with that.
You know one. I mean, you know, they got this big, long page. All this is going to be our show notes, so go check it out, linuxgamecast.com. But, I mean, this thing takes forever to scroll down. You get to the bottom, you click tech specs, I'm like, give me a price. Like, poof, smoke bomb. Why? It's quite simple. Because this thing is not a Steam Deck competitor. I mean, this, if it's over $400, it doesn't compete with a Steam Deck. It's in that market of... I don't know what the target audience is. In a world where the Steam Deck exists, and you can kind of pretty much get one if you're a little bit patient, it's going to be few and far between people who are like hyper impatient, like, well, I can buy this right now. How much will it cost? Well, just an extra $800 on top of your Steam Deck. And hey, same thing, kind of, if you squint.
Talking about iterative design, I do like the fact that other companies are trying to, like, push the form factor. Again, I'll bring up the external GPU because I think that's something that maybe Steam Deck 2 might want to consider. But yeah, like, I don't know. people are really taking handheld computers seriously. They're trying to make like an actual console experience out of it. Regardless of the success of the GPD Win 4, I think there's useful lessons to be had from the success or failure of this device. And I'm interested to see what other companies will take from it.
And I do think it's a very important thing to point out. This is what it costs to actually make one of these things. If you don't think the price of your Steam Deck is subsidized, come down to reality, because we were talking about this during the break. You know, this isn't a Vin, Pedro, and Jordan's slappy, fun-time portable handheld shack. GP's been around for a while. They can put in pretty sizable orders, component-wise, to get the cost down. That's what one of these little motherfuckers really cost when you don't have a store attached to it that you can make the financial decision, or at least, you know, got that Val's got enough cash to go up to AMD and be like, hey, custom silicon, AMD is like,
for sale. Yeah, oh, make us this.
Yeah, they didn't do that because they were BFFs, man. So, yeah. I mean, and it runs Windows, because, I mean, I'm sure some people are still highly, violently allergic to Linux. They don't want to be...
They need their Destiny fix, man.
I guess.
Yeah, they need to play Destiny on the go when they don't have internet.
Well, this one has an LTE modem attachment. So.
It does. If you put the wall wart on the back, you can put a little card in. That seems like a design error, doesn't it? Like, isn't that something like you just want to make an LTE version?
Yeah, and again, like this is a neat feature that I think maybe Steam Deck 2, maybe have like a premium model that has some stuff like
There's
this.
There's something to be said about the expandability. Just give people the option that if they want, they can have the little wart with the extra battery or with the extra LTE modem or whatever the case may be.
Yeah, take a bit of like a framework computer approach. That would be fucking neat.
Yeah, and you can buy the deep cycle marine battery attachment.
Yeah, you can hook it up to like a Segway and drive around. Yeah,
mm-hmm. I mean, as long as the Segway has a Type C port. Yeah,
yeah, why not?
I mean, most of them do nowadays. I'm gonna go ahead and assume. But, don't quote me on it. Segway salesman, man. Send me some hate mail.
Catnip, baby.
Yeah, Magnolia Catnip is a bit of a strange name, but that's because it's one of these bizarre release names for the Rare game launcher, not to be confused with the Heroic game launcher. Uh-huh. Although this is based off a lot of the same tech. It is using Legendary behind the scenes. Legendary is the command line utility that allows you to hook into the Epic Games store. But yeah, this is Rare. They have a new release out. They're chugging away on it. They have some they have some screenshots, but this looks to be some sort of a competitor to Heroic. This one seems to be a little more focused on the Epic Games store. Heroic is trying to be like, hey, we'll do GOG, we'll do Epic Games, we'll do a bunch of stuff for you. They do have a Flatpak and an app image, or you can install this from pip. And yeah, looking at the screenshots, it does look very bare bones compared to Heroic. And like, Heroic had a major glow up. I remember when we first started talking about it compared to now, it looks like a real ass piece of software. This still is having a bit of like a programmer art chic to it, but they're working on it. They got some catching up to do, but I'm not opposed to any more competition in that space. They don't really say what really differentiates them, but you know, hey,
work. I mean, to what you were saying though, I mean, this is something Valve got right, that, you know, in three decades or two point close enough to be three decades of one, it is not being overly complex. It's getting it down to that fucking play button level of user interaction.
You have the one store, the one client, it just runs that.
Well, it's not even the store or the client. It's like, how do I use this abstract? You click the play button, and if it doesn't work, then what? No, just go on to something else. Like, okay, so if I click play and it works, and yeah, you don't even think about it. You remove that level of friction, and you get something as like, you know, the popularity of Proton, not you click here and here's your bazillion option menu, and that's not what the average person wants. They just want to go play the damn game.
Yeah, and the thing that actually kind of caught me off guard is people at work who have an Epic account because they want the free games that they give out every week. You know, the fair use point.
Windhaven is free this week, by the way. So
yeah, they're using stuff like Heroic on Windows. Because apparently the actual EGS client's a bit shit. So, yeah, go figure.
Strange times. Not as strange as Vulcan and my super text card.
It was bound to happen eventually.
Well, we got a new RC kit. You know what? I don't know if we'll be able to play this in the after shows or not, man. This release mainly focuses on visual changes. Notably, our collectible items now have more dynamic and polished way to interact with players. Yes, Look at that tiny little window. It looks so dynamic and interactive. What else is in here, man? Because I downloaded it. I'm like, okay, I'll play around with it. And apparently there's some Vulkan sauce. Molten API, yes. DX12.
Experimental Vulkan renderer. They hit the Vulkan button! Woohoo!
There's a Godet mascot. I'm looking for the Vulkan stuff. Here it is.
All at the bottom. Yep.
Render driver Vulkan. So I decided to try this out, and here's what happened. I punched that in the command line. I downloaded the precompiled binary to like build the source. It opened up with a warning about outdated OpenGL drivers. Then it refused to go into any other resolution than 1024x768.
Oops. I mean, it's an RC, right? So there's still got some jank to work out.
So yeah, my Vulkan button didn't work very well. But apparently, if you're in a networking lobby, you can just do a /Vulkan or /GL to revert.
Yeah, you do need to restart SuperTux card afterwards. So you can do it with the command line option. There's an option in config XML, and then you can just do it via the game client, and it will update it via the standard configurator. So, like, yeah, it's good to see. I mean, I don't think this is going to result in new insane graphics for SuperTux card. It's going to look the same, but it's just going to be Vulkan on the back end. It's going to be pretty neat.
There's Godet.
I do wonder, will it remove the 104 FPS cap that it used to
have? Do you really need your SuperTux card to run at 144 frames a second, Pedro?
Pedro's absolutely. I have a 144 monitor. Not only that is, he will find a impenetrable wall of nonsense to justify this being a minimum requirement in order for him to do so. He has the tools necessary.
Yes, but I will very much praise a game or any kind of software that does make use of the 144 functionality. I like it.
What is the 144 functionality?
The 144 hertz refresh rate that this monitor offers. I'm not Isn't even that... talking about the FreeSync.
Well, you just disable VSync, bro.
That causes tearing.
That's terrible.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I guess that's it for the news. Oh, wait, no, we got one more thing to talk about. We're going to talk about icky butts.
Yes, Oil of Hope dropped this into the show suggestions on Discord, which is a thing you can do if you're one of our Patreons. And yes, Iculus made the post about creating an SDL 3D renderer, effectively. It's a 3D API, very high-level 3D API, which focuses on the shaders, which will be written in their own language, SDL, CL, as the case may be, and then it passes everything else down to the lower-level mantle-based APIs, which we're more or less familiar with. That's your Metal, your Direct3D 12s, and your Vulkans. They plan to have limp mode enabled for DirectX 11 and OpenGL 4.5. So, you know, that's a possibility. But yeah, if you have an older OpenGL or DirectX 10, DirectX 9, yeah, you're not gonna. And the Sony PSP Vita homebrew renderer doesn't get support either.
Well, they are looking at supporting web GPU in the future though, and yeah. we were talking about that as sort of like, yeah, it's this API target that no one really cares about, but it is well supported and well documented everywhere. Right? Yeah.
Icky goes on to say, it's like, hey, I would like to thank the fine people at Epic Games for the mega grant to get the work started on this.
Yes.
Also, where's Visual SDL?
that needs the Microsoft mega grant before that can happen. But yeah,
I will chip it. I want SDL blocks, Achilles.
So, but yeah, there's going to be a new bytecode format. I guess they just don't want to use HLSL, GLSL, simply because they don't want to pull in LLVM as a dependency. But hey, it's cool stuff.
Yeah, that's cool, but that's also in danger of like XKCD in it, man.
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, you can still write your own like Vulkan renderer for and just use SDL for like input and networking and stuff.
So. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, and there's something to be said. I still remember that presentation that Iculus was doing where he showed
compatibility.
The amount of code, the lines of code that you needed to spawn a window in Direct3D, and then you needed like three lines in SDL or five lines if you wanted error checking. So basically translating that to an entire 3D API and just making that much simpler for people to try and get into it. That's not a bad idea.
It's Estiel's been a slow burn. Estiel had to come in and work up, basically butting heads with, 20 years of Microsoft.
Yeah.
It's been a slow burn, but it's been a good burn. So
it's baked into Unreal Engine 5, right? It's a core component. So shit. Mm-mm-mm. It earned its place at the table. Coming up next, I was about to fall down some stairs, but then I looked at it from another angle, and then I started falling up the stairs. We're throwing chairs at Cron Escher coming up next.
Vomited.
Welcome back to the Checkquisition. This week we're taking a look at Cron Escher. No, it's not. It's not Cron Escher. It's Cron Escher. It's developed by Purple Sloth. It's done on the Unity engine. You can pick it up for about $5. What is this game of ours that we're throwing chairs at? Cron Escher is a challenging turn-based puzzle
this
game in Escher.
Game of mine.
Yeah, Escher S spaces, impossible geometries, teleportation, and environmental snapshots to navigate your mind and uncover your lost memories. We gotta thank Purple Sloth for sending us some keys over Curator Connect for the Chairquisition, which you may not be aware of what it is. It's what you're watching right now. It's where we take a game, run it on a bunch of different Linux distributions and with a bunch of different hardware. And then we give you a hyper perspective, rate it on a chair from one to, or rate it on a scale from 1 to 4 chairs. 1 chair means that it's shit. 4 chairs means that it's fucking great. Let's get into this. Pedro, have you fallen down some stairs recently?
No, but I did fall up a few, and then I fell into a portal and took a picture of the world around me to go back in time. Over here on the Ryzen 7 3700X with the RX 6700 RX? Yes, RX 6700 XT. On Nobara nowadays, it launched out of the box. It's fairly barren. The option screen is fairly barren, but it did hold 144 at 2560 by 1440, so that's all I care about. It's very much a mouse/touchscreen affair, though you can use the left and right keys on the keyboard to turn the map around, which you will need to do on the accounts of the Escher-esque things. The graphics are very simple, and the music is very, very inoffensive. It's perfectly functional. On a technical level, I have absolutely nothing to point at. As for the fun, well, did you like Monument Valley? Because this is Cairn Gully, effectively. If putting Escher in the name didn't tip you off, there's a lot of impossible geometry shenanigans happening. Oh, but I can hear you say, this gets boring after a while. If it's always the same thing, there's only so many times you can rotate something to actually come up with a solution. Yeah, I thought so too. Right up until you finish the first round of levels, and they give you another 2 paths that you can choose. One of them is the one that you're looking at the video version that has the portal. The other one is the one that's going to come up next, because this is the point where I gave up on the portal levels because I couldn't figure it out.
Oh, I beat this one. Haha. Take that.
Same.
Yeah, no, that was the one that I went, okay, no, I'll come back to this later. And I went to the other path, which has the snapshot mechanic. If you remember that game, it basically allows you to take a picture of something to make the world go back to the way it used to be. And it is, I'm guessing the third chapter will probably, you get to use the snapshot and the portals and the Escher-esque impossible geometry all at once. So it gets proper mindfucky in the best possible way. For the price, it is a good game to have on your laptop, and it doesn't have very high requirements at all. To give your brain a proper workout if your job is otherwise completely mind-numbing. So, as far as I'm concerned, 4 chairs. No complaints whatsoever.
Pretend there's 4 chairs there. I wasn't expecting. Wait, hang on, there it is.
It's happening. Oh my
BBQ.
Man, 10 years in, we figured it out. So on Fedora, 35, 64-bit, because I'm too lazy to upgrade with the R9 3900X and the GTX 1080 Ti because it's too expensive to upgrade right now. It launches out of the box. It holds 60 at full screen, quote-unquote. There's a full screen tick box in the options menu, and you can drag your resolution of choice. I think it just does scales, because, you know, why not? No controller support, just click, which makes me think this was a mobile port. Then I went and looked on the Play Store. Doesn't exist. iOS Store doesn't exist. Apparently, you gotta sideload that shit from itch. So, I don't know. And it's a little unfortunate because there's not really anything mouse or touch specific about the UI. Like, it could be perfectly serviceable on a controller. They just chose not to add the support, which is a little unfortunate. The graphics, they get the job done. The art style is a little sparse. It's pretty minimal, but no real complaints because you can see what's happening very clearly, and there's no lack of clarity to that. The harp loop gets a little grating after a while. I wish there was a little bit more variety in the music, but again, not really a deal breaker. Fun-wise, yeah, it's a little decent puzzler. Gotta rotate the camera and change the perspective to change the level a la Captain Toad, and having to deal with sliding block puzzles from multiple angles is a fun little twist on your Sokoban formula. And, you know, once you get past the tutorial first level, first collection of levels anyways, they toss some modifiers at you, like using portals, using snapshots, as Pedro alluded to. You can snapshot and restore. They're it. And, you know, I had to stop playing because it's like, God, this is going to take too long to figure out and I just don't have the energy. When you have to stop playing, not because of frustration, but due to like sheer mental exhaustion, I think you have a pretty solid puzzle game here. There is a story, but they're doing the nonverbal storytelling thing. You got to find fragments within the puzzles. There are optional puzzles that you can do to unlock them and unlock the fragments of your shattered past. What does it mean? I don't know. You woke up somewhere in a hospital and now you have to deal with M.C. Escher paintings. But honestly, I'm not here for the story. I'm here for the puzzles. And as far as they go, they're pretty well done. So I'm going to give it 3 cheers. It's a good game.
Right on, right on. So let me get my clock going over here on Debian. Not stable, not living on the edge, baby. Debian testing on a Ryzen 1920X with a 3060. Yes, one of those little guys. Powering the GPU. You know, it launches clean. No problems. Full screen and choose your own adventure mode. We're available for your resolutions, you know. No official controller support, but it attempts that emulation mode that you get, you know, with your PS4s, with your Xbox, and it's arguably completely unusable. However, Andy and a lot of clicking. That's what you're getting. Keyboard and gerbil. Now, performance settings, none of those. Really don't need them, because you'd be kind of hard-pressed to find something that this wouldn't run on, which is good. But you do get the basic batch volume and music sliders, so you can kind of adjust there, pretend you have options. Now, let's go to the fun thing, because this game is, or was, originally designed from the ground up for touch, I should say, at least, because there's an Android and iOS version, and as soon as you start touching this, it makes a lot more sense. You know, anything with a touchscreen. So, I don't know why it's not on the Play Store, I don't know why it's on the, whatever the Apple Play Store is, but if you're going to play this on your Steam Deck, get ready to use the touch, because there's no way you're going to be using the keyboard mouse emulation gamepad thing. It's pretty atrocious. Now, I went reading around on their forums, and they're like, hey, we don't exactly know how the game could be played with the joysticks. That's what Purple Sloth said when they were asked, like, hey, could you add proper controller support? Grids. Grids is how you do this. Every other fucking puzzle game like this in the history of ever that has proper controller support. This is grid-based. You highlight the grids with your left stick, and you move with the other one. That's all you got to do. However, for $4.99, you do, in fact, get a little fun puzzle game. I mean, it scratches your brain on the occasion, and in the right way. It'll even hurt your brain if you let it. Level design's nice. I enjoyed the perspective twist the first time I did it. I'm like, motherfucker, that's a good thing from me. That
when
is me.
You get the three perspectives, yeah, too.
That's, I'm like, fuck, portals, goddammit, and that's good. My brain enjoys that. Unfortunately, like most of the mobile-first games, this is better experience than like quick hits. Pull it out, you pick it up, you have 3 or 4 minutes to kill. Hey, let's take another crack at that level we're stuck on. Even playing on the desktop, I found myself like checking mail on Reddit and shit, like intentionally just taking little breaks. And I think these games work best if you're going to be playing them on the PC as a sit-back experience where you can just kind of zone the hell out and focus on this one thing instead of sitting in front of your desktop. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, it is cheap. You know, it's a couple of bucks, $3, $4, something like that. I'm going to say it's apples. Even like that, it's easy to get distracted and it's hard to say that this has everything it takes for that, you know, desktop experience where you're going to sit around and not fuck off and do other things, but enough of it's there for the price that you can get some enjoyment out of it. But yeah, add some real controls to it. I'll give it a solid 2.
Yeah, this really does seem like something that would work really, really well on the deck as well. And just the lack of controller support just kills that. It's unfortunate.
It's are you still with us, Pedro?
I am. I was waiting. People were talking. I was waiting.
Well, it's that mixture of that, and you just don't move sometimes. So I'm like,
listen, I'm a T-Rex, and my vision is based on movement. He's trying to avoid getting eaten.
You know what?
A good defensive mechanism, you know?
Here's the thing. You can excuse a lot because this game's like $4, man.
Yeah. And like
there's definitely more than $4 worth of game in here. It's the getting to that $4, having to use a keyboard and mouse. This is the only hang up because I think I like shit like this because, you know, it's something a little bit new. You know, it's Escher-esque punk type thing going on. It's got a little story behind it. And it genuinely caused me to say out loud, fuck you. Even at the one where Pedro tapped out with the portals, that took me. I was like, I know I can beat this. It's that argument you get to have with yourself. You're like, I know I can figure this out.
This one took me a minute.
yeah. It really is like, and it is kind of fun to like experiment with the levels and do all the trial and error stuff and be like, oh, that's how I get over here. Or, I need to figure out a way to get over here because that's the only place that's accessible.
I need to get on this block so that when I turn the camera, it's over there.
Very, very well constructed puzzles. Really just needs controller support. I think that's the biggest gripe here. Coming up next, we got to talk about switching out power supplies and why you should lick the motherboard header before you plug it in.
12 pins of deliciousness.
Are we going? Okay, I guess we're going. I was semi-distracted by a Schwarmageddon that I posted.
Busy beating up elementary children.
No, I was reading the little blurb for Swords and Soldiers to Schwarmageddon. It is unfortunate that that game didn't have a Linux version because that would totally be a thing that I just send the developers an email and didn't even care about anything else. Just send
keys they're just gonna send you shawarma through the mail.
Yeah,
moldy
I wouldn't
shawarma.
Be opposed to that. I could go for some shawarma right about now. It's only 4:15 in the morning here, so
that's shawarma time.
If you'd like to tell us which of the spinny kind of thinly sliced meats you like to stuff your gob with, you absolutely can. Just go to linuxgamecast.com, hit the contact button. There's some caveats at the top. They don't apply to any of the meat stuff. Don't worry about it. Don't quote me on that. Fill out the form. LGC Weekly is the show you want to send your hate mail to. Or you can send Ven and Jill some feedback for the Wednesday show. You can ask Jordan for relationship advice. It is it's good times.
Hey, man. And come check us out live. Do all the fun stuff. It looks like we might be playing UT. I was just looking back in Discord and
like, Mr. Hey, Alert never shut it down.
Alan's just like, the server never went anywhere. You're the one that left. So we might be playing around with that in the after shows. But up first, we have the Linux noob writing about power, because I believe I fucked up and said no one's ever been excited about buying a power supply before. No,
yeah, I guess he makes a good point though.
Linux noob says, I recently did a power supply swap and was very excited about it. To be fair though, it was only because I needed the power supply to install a new graphics card.
Yeah, that's legitimate.
But I guess, yeah, technically you are excited about installing a new power supply, but that's not the whole picture. It still counts.
Right, it's not the power supply. It's a means to an end, right?
But I mean,
it's still excitement. It's like, ooh, new hardware, so I can use even more new hardware.
But yes. I think in that equation, you're excited about the new graphics card.
Oh, I mean, the graphics card is useless without the new power supply. So
you can't play it without the new power supply.
I'm really excited about this 3090. I'm just going to stare at the box of.
Okay, this does bring in the question. Did you have a criminally overpowered GPU or a criminally underpowered PSU?
That's an interesting question.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you got like a 350 watt. You're trying to run like a, well, like, yeah, a 60. Well,
yeah. Immediately, we're all thinking like, oh yeah, you're trying to plug in a 3090 Ti to a 200. And it's like, no, what if he was trying to plug in, I don't know, a 480 into a 120 watt Dell?
Yeah, no, 480 wouldn't work. No, even the RX 480. No.
We got questions, maybe you got answers, and real quick, still on the ARC train, baby.
Yeah,
the Darth Tux.
Darth Tux. I was gonna mispronounce that. The high house. So good on you, Pedro.
The Darth Tux. I don't think so.
He's talking about the A770s. If priced right, I would get the A770 just for the AV1 encoding.
No, you wouldn't, sir. You're lying to everyone. You would go ahead and just get the 360 right now that you can buy.
Yeah, just get the cheaper one places. That's like the dedicated AV1 encoder and can't really do much of anything else. It's the A380. Yeah.
That's hey, man. No, I feel you on the... Oh, jeez. I've seen some people trying to be like, oh, well, hey, man, the A380 sold out everywhere, so clearly there's demand for them. Like, how many of those cards do you think fucking Intel?
Yeah, they made like 10.
Right.
Yeah, it was real, the low end.
Real easy to be out of stock when that was the game plan, you know? But, you know, even in... I'm in that boat. Like, if I genuinely had a spare PCI Express hole, if you're at home, you probably have one.
I do.
Yeah. If all you have is the one GPU, then yeah, you can probably just slot that underneath.
Like, I absolutely would be fucking around with that shit this afternoon. But, yeah, I wouldn't need a 770. I mean, 770. Okay. What price do you, nibble on the 770? Knowing that it's, probably it's
not going, probably 3060 level. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe if you're being very generous with it, okay. Jordan, would there be any interest though? Like, 'cause that would definitely be a card that's like, it's almost as fast as your existing card.
Oh yeah. Honestly, I was thinking like, if I got an Intel card, I would cram it in the kid's computer so that he can run into all the issues. I don't know. I'd probably nibble on a 7070, like $300 even. Wouldn't do more than that.
Under 300, yeah.
So we're talking like 300 Canadian, so let's say 225.
U.S. Yeah.
Oh no. Like 300.
Yeah.
I think the most I'd pay for like a 770, because again, silicon, we've been over this, doesn't age well. This thing's not getting faster no matter what they do to the
end. And being the Intel driver stack, you're going to be running into some issues with DX9 and DX10 games. Remains to be seen how that works in the Proton.
Tom was on, I think, a Hot Hardware, but it was like 2 weeks ago, and they're like, so you guys are learning about drivers and GPU drivers. He's like, no, we've been making drivers for 20 years. So I was like, what's your fucking excuse then?
Well, apparently there's a war going on. That was their excuse.
So yeah, I don't know, man.
I guess on Linux we do have the advantage that everything is running Vulkan, and it apparently can do Vulkan okay.
Whoever is, because like the 40 series, AMD, come on, do me AMD a solid.
Can have the Sony moment after Microsoft tried to pull that bullshit with the Xbox One about it having to be always online and you couldn't do used games, and Sony walked on stage like, yeah, you can do all that.
AMD
can do that, but with the price, it's like, yeah, no, it's the same price as last time.
I look forward to that happening. Me buying whatever card I end up buying and finding out that like it just melts your computer and like drains your bank account. Because there's some awful flaw with it. That's usually my luck. That's what happened with the Skylake CPU.
Like, here's my hope for RDNA3, because Intel had the opportunity. They had the thing. Shit happened, some within and some definitely outside of Intel's control, but they fucked the ball on this one. So this round one of Intel arc just is a whatever. It's a curiosity fuck.
It's a wash.
For like the first time in my adult life might be the first time that there will be a legitimate like fight between Team Red and Team Green, like where it's genuinely down to price, not, oh, I'm going to sacrifice this and this and this. I mean, you're going to see something with AV1 encoding, ray tracing support. There's going to be second gen for that on AMD's side too. Rasterization performance, that remains to be seen.
Gaggles of VRAM, yeah. Like,
yeah. Yes. Like, I can't remember the last time. Write in if you remember the last time that you could legitimate. I'm talking like legitimately. I don't want fan humans on either side to go, well, I, you know, no, like, AMD GPUs are kind of a dog shit, but they've been significantly less dog shit with the starting with like what the 5700 series, the XTs.
Yeah, the once they got the driver sorted, yeah, the RX 5000s. Apparently, the drivers for those now are getting a little wiggy depending on what bleeding edge version of Mesa you're on. I haven't looked into it. On Fedora, seems to be fine. So I don't know.
I don't know. You're gonna get like the one person with like a Vegas 7.
Oh yeah, oh, driver problems.
Ooh, those Radeon 7s. If you have one, please do let us know how that's still going. If it's still
going. Hey Pedro, listen, I will have you. AMD supported the drivers for that $1,000 card for like 9 full months.
Yeah, it was less than a year. That was terrible.
On that uplifting bombshell, ladies and gentlemen, let's cue the music. You can always find our nightmare train pulling out of the station at 8:30 Eastern Standard Time. If you're one of the awesome carbon-based entities who support us on Patreon at a death note or above, hop in to the pre-super shows, and where we have just that. We also have at 7:30 Wizards and Shit, followed by pre-super shows, and we'll be there to talk with you live one-on-one. You can always find this back here on Twitch at 8:30 Eastern Standard Mood Time. Check out the schedule, linuxgamecast.com. All the information. We're available on YouTube, available on the Odyssey's and the libraries, available on Spotify, video version as well, at Reply Vinstone on Twitter. That's where I'm hanging out. Or if you like the Mastodons, we get one of those. I'm just at Vin at mast.linuxgamecast.com.
I'm Jordan. I'm currently torn between Team Red and Team Green, so I guess I'm on Team Red. Follow me on Twitter at The Burning Fool or twitch.tv.
Yellow slash and purple make plaid or some shit. I don't know.
I don't know, the red and green, when you mix those, that's brown, so you're on Team Poop.
Team Noctua, baby. Team yeah. Noctua.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I am wearing the brown and beige headset. Not Noctua, but yeah. If you want to tell me, like, I can't remember who it was, FX Boy? One of them, that told me that they didn't like the color of my headset. You can do that too. Go on Twitter at unaccounted for and let me know how wrong you are.
That's... looks like a human Dalmatian. Look at him.
No, Pedro. Nobody likes the color of your headset. Only one person cared enough to let you know.
Credits. who would you get? That's just a fun game. Fuck. Shit. Can we just get everyone to come back? Can we just get, like, Season 8 of Deep Space Nine? Can we just, like, please? Well, we got... Maybe our advisors can make that happen with their amazing monetary donations. We gotta thank Omegas, Arthur, and we gotta thank our executive producers.
Well, that's rock. Who is they? Barbara Bob Brandt, Scott M, Atomic Ass, Mike G, Kawaku, George. Pebble, Tomas, and Uno.
Uno. Chicago uh-huh. Kicks Ass. Our lone little Licky fan, Abstraction. He's still in there.
Yup. And sea of course, monsters. You got the Sea Monsters, Renault, Rider X, Machina, Trudgy, Vertanuda, Justin, Frostclaw, Nubbin, David, Darkwing, and System T.
Death Notes, Nova, Basil B, Chad, and Dak, Kim, who's watching the show tonight?
Marcin, Benjamin, Dirty Dean,
Oil of Hope.
Oil of Hope's usually watching.
Dodger,
Kai Yore. Got the Chairlings, Jason,
North Lord Ranger, Loka. I know who's watching tonight.
Let's Das see. Geek, Brocky, Mr. Amish.
Mirror's
in there.
Yeah. Colin T and Mag.
Oh, probably.
Ogiwan's in there. Felatio. Sacred Egg.
Belric's name is misspelled.
Strider's in here.
Fine upstanding cannibals. Carl and Mike and Arthur and Lytics Drew and Aldius and Noctilus and John and Eshep and Gamatron. Ha.
Do you need to thank one you of those to Mark like, and
shirts?
Replay Gaming PT, their newest Patreons. Thank you ever so much.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Friends don't let friends buy, I don't know.
Arc GPUs?
Noctua video cards.
Ooh, yeah, I know. Those I mean, aces.
Now that EVGA is getting out of the business, Nox was stepping up.
Now, baby, EVGB's in the house.
Five dudes.